To call to order our regular city council meeting, Madam Clerk, will you confirm posting and roll call?
Mayor, this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All members of the council are present and you have a quorum.
Thank you. Mr. Snow, are there any changes to our regular council meeting today?
Yes, Mayor, there are a number of changes. Item 6 has been continued to the October 15th meeting at the request of staff. Item 16 is staying on the agenda, but the applicant printed on the agenda is the applicant. It's listed doing business as Joker's Wild, but should read Eldorado Incorporated. Item 17, the applicant printed on the agenda is doing business as Chapman Chrysler Jeep, but should read Chapman Chrysler Jeep LLC. Item 35 has been continued to the October 15th City Council meeting at the request of the applicant. And item 36 has also been continued to the October 15th, 2013 City Council meeting at the request of the applicant, but there was a misprint in the CPA number. The number should read CPA-13-500287, and the original attachment titled Resolution was incorrect, and the corrected version titled Updated Resolution was published on the web on September 26, 2013. Item 41 has been continued to the October 15th, 2013 City Council meeting at the request of the applicant. Item 43 has been continued to the November 19th, 2013 City Council meeting at the request of staff. Item 47 has been continued to the October 15th, 2013 City Council meeting at the request of staff. And also, I'd like to note that there has been a request to move item 54 this evening to be heard right after our consent agenda, if that's the pleasure of the mayor and council.
All right. So before I call for a motion to accept the agenda as amended, we still need to have an invocation and a pledge of allegiance. So Larry Palmer from the Calvary Chapel of Henderson will lead us an invocation. We'll remain standing during the invocation, and afterwards we'll have the pledge of allegiance.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council, for your opportunity to come and pray this evening. Won't you join me in prayer? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening humbly acknowledging you as the omniscient ruler of all. You see and know all things. As such, we come asking your wisdom tonight for these who make the decisions for our city. Help them see clearly all that is presented. Help them to know the best way to proceed in the matters they face. I pray also that those decisions would be honest and righteous, that they would be pleasing in your sight. For if that's the case, I know they'll be the best decisions for our community. You say in your word that rulers should rule in righteousness and justice. Help them carry this out tonight, knowing that they will ultimately answer to you. I thank you for each of them and their willingness to serve our community, and ask that you would bless their efforts in accordance with your will, as we ask these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I also need to state that these meetings are being video recorded and streamed live to the web. And we actually have some scouts with us here this evening. From the Boy Scouts, we have Troop 564 here for citizenship in the community and to get their tenderfoot. And then also Troop 512 for their communications. And Troop 931 is working on citizenship in the world. And then also we have Troop 135, Girl Scout Troop 135 here. Matter of fact, would all the scouts stand so we can see who we are and recognize you? Come and stand up. Don't be shy. You bet. Now, this is kind of a really special treat because we get a lot of Boy Scouts coming, but not very often do we get Girl Scout troops here. So you're going to hear this spiel that I give to the Boy Scouts, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the Girl Scouts too, because the Boy Scouts have what's called an Eagle Award. And we promise as a city council that we will be to any Eagle Court of Honor for those of you that go on and get that Eagle rank. And I understand that the senior Girl Scouts have an opportunity to earn the gold badge. And we'll make that same offer that we support scouting so much that we'll make every effort if we get invited to, I don't know if they have a ceremony like they have a court of honor for the Eagle rank, but if they have a ceremony for the gold badge, we'd really like to know about that too. Because we really do support scouting and what both Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts for what those organizations teach the young men and the young women. Because really, that's what it's all about, is giving service to your community. And I always end with this, kind of like my mantra, when you're in the service of your fellow man, which you're doing, being in service, then you're only in the service of your God. And if you keep that in mind, you'll be great citizens, and maybe even some of you will be right up here on the dais in a few years, just like we are. So thank you very much. Now, you heard the changes to the agenda. Are there any changes at the dais for the agenda? Then a motion to accept the agenda would be in order.
Mayor, I'll go ahead and make a motion to accept the agenda as amended.
All right. We have a motion. Let's cast our votes. And post. Motion carries. Okay. So, Mr. Snow.
Thank you, Mayor. We now go to the proclamations, commendations, and presentations portions of your agenda. And we have three proclamations to deliver tonight. I'll go ahead and announce item number one, which is a proclamation for Cybersecurity Awareness Month. I'd like to invite Laura Fucci and Ryan Turner to step forward and join the mayor and council at the podium. Computer technology plays a vital role in our daily lives, and internet users face increasing risk of cyber attack. The City of Henderson joins with industry leaders and other government agencies in observing Cybersecurity Awareness Month to encourage our citizens, students, and businesses to protect their computers and our nation's critical cyber infrastructure. The Mayor and City Council would like to present a proclamation declaring October 2013 as Cybersecurity Awareness Month in the City of Henderson.
You know, I've been actually doing this for a long time, over 26 years, and I can tell you that 26 years ago, who would have ever thought that we would have had a cybersecurity month? And so times, they've changed, and we feel really honored to have a great IT department. And I don't know if Laura or Ryan wants to say anything about this, but we do want to present this proclamation to you for the whole community.
I do have a few words because, you know, you can't give me a microphone. Cybersecurity, every 3 seconds, somebody has their identity compromised. You know, identity fraud every 3 seconds. So a lot's happening right now as we stand up here and talk about it. Cybersecurity or cybercrime has now become, has taken over the sale of illicit drugs as far as how much money is made through cybercrime worldwide. So this has really become a prominent problem in our world, in our nation. So I invite all citizens, businesses, and employees to learn more about cybersecurity and find ways to make sure they don't become a victim in this area. There's a lot of resources out there. StopThinkConnect.org is a federal resource that has very simple tricks to make sure that we're all protected in this space. There's a new one in Nevada that is CyberSafeNV.org. It just started today. So that's another resource that's available. So I encourage you to go online and look at those areas and find ways to make sure that you're safe as a citizen of the cyberspace. Have anything to add? Okay.
Well, Laura Fucci is our Chief Information Officer in IT, and then Ryan Turner is our Emergency Management Coordinator. So that's the reason why they're up here. So, Mandy?
Item two is a proclamation for Pedestrian Safety Month. Next, I'd like to ask Rosemary Johnson and Cindy Zedek to please step forward. Throughout the month of October, the City of Henderson joins with other Southern Nevada entities to support and promote Pedestrian Safety Month. In the past few years, the number of pedestrians fatally injured in accidents has risen in Southern Nevada. The Mayor and City Council would like to urge all residents to recognize the importance of pedestrian safety and be especially careful while driving or walking in our community. Joining us this evening are Crossing Guard Supervisors Rosemary Johnson and Cindy Zedek to accept a proclamation declaring October 2013 as Pedestrian Safety Month.
Well, of course, it is very, very important that we have pedestrian safety in our communities. And, you know, one thing that I have learned over the years, too, is that just because you're in a crosswalk, this is especially for the young people here, doesn't necessarily mean that you're safe. You got to look both ways, and you have to protect yourselves, too. So we really, as a mayor and council, want to bring this forward for the awareness of our public. And I don't know either one of you or both of you want to say something or too shy.
I'm too shy, she might.
Since when are you shy? Thank you. This is a great honor. We appreciate it. And we couldn't do it without the people that we have working for us directly. So thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a team effort.
And as item number three, a proclamation for Domestic Violence Awareness Month, I'd like to invite Susie Lewis, Julie Proctor, and Dodie Rare to come forward to the podium. When domestic violence occurs, it breaks the core of human spirit and violates an individual's privacy, dignity, and humanity. The City of Henderson partners with a network of public and private agencies to raise awareness of domestic violence and provide support to victims. By learning more about domestic violence and the services available to our citizens, we are taking active steps to protect ourselves from domestic violence and join with others to make the City of Henderson a safe place to live, work, and play. The Mayor and City Council would like to present Susie Lewis, Julie Proctor, and Dodie Rare, and Susie, in particular, a victim advocate with the Henderson Police Department, with a proclamation declaring October 2013 as Domestic Violence Awareness Month in the City of Henderson.
This is one of those situations where, you know, there's the good and the bad. We really do need to bring this awareness to the forefront. I mean, it's unfortunate that we do have instances of domestic violence, but I do have to applaud, you know, our team, our city employees, and those groups out in the community that really strive actually every day, every hour, every minute to make more people aware of these situations and what we can do to make ourselves better as a community. And so I'm assuming, Susie, that you are going to say a few words.
I'll say a couple words. Okay. Give me a microphone.
Okay.
First, I want to introduce Dodie. She is our victim advocate at the West Station. I work out of the East Station, and we have another advocate who is not able to be with us tonight who works out of the North Station. So we're one of the few agencies, police agencies in the Valley that has an advocate in each substation. So that's a great thing that we've been able to accomplish. I want to thank the mayor and the city council for this proclamation. Domestic violence is a horrible thing, and we strive every day to help our victims move forward with their lives. And I think one of the best things that can happen is to have a victim, which just happened to me this week, that I had not had contact with in about 3 years, call me to tell me how well she's doing and to thank me for what help we were able to give her. On another note, real quickly, I just wanted to mention that as part of Domestic Violence Awareness Month, the police officer car, the cars in the police department will all have domestic violence metallic ribbons on their cars for the whole month, signifying Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Thank you.
Thank you.
And that concludes our proclamation portion of the agenda for this evening. Mayor and Council, our next item is the City Manager's Report. And we have some good news to share with you this evening. These lovely people in the picture in front of you are Henderson Parks and Recreation Department employees, and recently they brought home 6 awards from the Nevada Recreation and Park Society's annual Program Excellence Awards. Awards were received in the categories of staff development, outdoor recreation, and sports. In addition, we received 3 Elmer Anderson Park Excellence Awards for Reunion Trails Park, McCullough Hills Trail, and Heritage Park. Congratulations to these employees and to Parks and Recreation Department Director Mary Ellen Donner and her team. Let's have a round of applause for these people. Thank you, Mayor and Council. This concludes tonight's City Manager's Report, and that means that the next item on our agenda is the consent agenda, and that is made up of a number of items, and they all can be taken together in one motion if so desired.
All right, I have no cards for any item to be pulled for discussion. If an item is not pulled for discussion, we make one motion that approves all consent agenda items. Is there anyone in the audience that wants one pulled for discussion or at the dais? Right, then a motion to approve the consent agenda would be in order.
Mayor, I'll go ahead and make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
All right, we have a motion on the floor. Cast your votes and post. And the motion carries.
Thank you, Mayor. We now go to item 54, which is a presentation from the Southern Nevada Water Authority Integrated Resource Planning Advisory Committee recommendations. With us here tonight is Mr. John Ensminger from the Water Authority. He's also joined by Mr. Guy Hobbs.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, thank you very much for having us here tonight. We're going to talk about 2 separate topics. We're going to give you an update on the ongoing drought on the Colorado River, as well as discuss the recommendations of the URPAC committee to the Southern Nevada Water Authority Board that will be coming before the council in the coming months. This graphic shows our 2 existing intakes in Lake Mead, located at elevation 1050 and elevation 1000, as well as the currently under construction 3rd intake, which will ultimately be at the very bottom of the lake at elevation 860. You see there the thermal climb that refers to the top 10 to 15 feet in Lake Mead that has very warm water in it, a lot of dissolved organics, and the relevance of that strata in the lake is that when it gets near our intakes, it becomes extremely difficult to treat that warmer water. This bar chart shows the last 13 years of the ongoing drought. You see there the dotted line is 100% of normal. You see in this century we have had 3 years at or above normal and 10 years substantially below normal, including 2012 and 2013, which are now confirmed as the driest back-to-back years within the Colorado River Basin in recorded history. The Bureau of Reclamation uses this chart based upon Lake Powell elevations to determine how much water they release from Lake Powell to Lake Mead each year. You can see that red line is now just below that elevation 3575. Lake Powell now has live storage of about 9.5 million acre feet out of a total of almost 25 million acre feet. So Lake Powell's at about 40% full right now. And as a result of being below that line, the Bureau in September determined that they would release 750,000 acre feet less water from Lake Powell to Lake Mead. And these are the results of that. You see here, there's a lot of different things on this chart. First, the solid red line, the horizontal line, is elevation 1050, where our upper intake is located. The pink shading is the 15 feet above that. This is truly new territory for us because Lake Mead has never been this low. Somewhere in that 15-foot band, we lose the operation of our upper intake. The red line going down is the September 24-month study, which shows that by the spring, summer of 2015, Lake Mead elevations will probably be about 40 feet lower than they are today, and will be within that red operating band, the pink operating band. So what are we doing about it? This schematic shows our system as it exists today. However, we recently issued a change order to construct the vertical shaft there that you can see in the red circle. That will allow our first pumping station to actually pull water from our second and third intakes, thereby securing that pumping station's ability to continue to produce water until at least elevation 1050. These charts just show how the lake is going to go down over about the next 12 months. You see right now we're at about elevation 1107. By the end of the year, we'll just drop a couple of feet. But by the end of July, you see us losing about 22 feet from where we are today. This chart is extremely busy, but I want to take time to explain what it is. This assumes the hydrology that we saw in the 20th century. And the 20th century, we know from the paleohydrology reconstructed from tree ring data, was one of the wettest time periods in the last 1,500 years on the Colorado River. So if we get that sort of wet century again going forward through 2060, we still see situations where we can be in very low shortage conditions in Lake Mead. And obviously, if we get worse hydrology than that going forward, those conditions could be worse. And then finally, this summarizes that same 106 years of record by showing those 13 years, again, the three above average years and the 10 below average years, including the second, fifth, and sixth driest years, again, in recorded history. So in the midst of this ongoing drought, our board asked a citizens committee to come together and look at our resource plan, our facilities, and our funding requirements. The committee has been meeting since the spring of last year. They've conducted 14 public meetings, but they've also been given voluminous amounts of material to absorb. So really those 14 meetings are just kind of the tip of the iceberg of the amount of work the citizens committee has put in. And really what they're looking at is the debt that's left over from the facilities the Water Authority has built in the last 15 to 20 years. You can see in 1995, these were the major regional facilities. But through 2002, major facilities, including the South Valley Lateral that serves parts of your community like Anthem, were all put in place. To the tune of $2.5 billion worth of capital improvements to put this plumbing into place for all segments of our community. Now, we get asked a lot of questions about what we've done to respond to the economic downturn. And one of the points I want to make, the SNWA is really a partnership. It's a partnership among the City of Henderson, the Las Vegas Valley Water District, North Las Vegas, Boulder City, and those partners pool their resources to build major regional infrastructure. We are a capital-driven organization, and as you can see, unlike most units of state or local government, our labor percentage of our budget that's driven by labor is extremely small. However, the major challenge we faced, as with a lot of the parts of our community in the teeth of the recession, is that one of our major funding components dried up. Our connection charge revenue went from $188 million in 2006 to a low of 3.2 million in 2010. It has come back up to $19 million in the last fiscal year, but that's still only about 10% of the peak. And the bill for those major capital facilities is what you can see here. By 2017, our annual debt service payments go up by about $100 million, and that is the task that our board asked the Citizens Committee to look at. How should we replace those connection charge revenues so that we can continue to make these debt service payments, maintain our bond rating, and move into the future? So with that, I'm going to turn it to Guy, and he's going to go over some of the key recommendations from the committee to our board.
Thank you very much. In looking at the finances of the Southern Nevada Water Authority going forward, as John just suggested to you, the main part of the expenditure side of the equation is rather fixed. We know what those obligations are. They exist in the form of debt service, and you can see that it peaks in 2017. And it remains at that peak for several years. The task before IRPAC was to look at the revenue side, including the connection charges and the other revenue sources that flow into the Water Authority, and see what kind of funding gap exists. And you can well imagine that with the devastation within the home building industry over the last several years, that the connection charge revenue is merely a shadow of its former self. So. Given that there was insufficient funding to maintain pace with the fixed costs of the authority, particularly those associated with debt service, the IRPAC committee looked at that funding gap and made recommendations as to how to fill the funding gap. As you recall, we had a similar process about a year ago where we were looking to fill a funding gap to deal with debt service without the advantage of having the IRPAC committee at that point in time selected a fixed charge option, the infrastructure surcharge, which included charges on fire meters, implemented that. That's working very well up to this point. But the IRPAC committee, even though they were focused on the 2017 funding gap when debt service hit it, the debt service requirements hit the peak, one of the recommendations they made was to actually phase the rates in 2014, 15, and 16. To lessen the rate shock in 2017. We'll come to a chart in a moment that'll demonstrate that. The committee also chose to recommend that the rates that were put into place last year, the infrastructure surcharge, including the fire meter charge, be left in place. That was an important recommendation, but there be no additional increases to the fire meter charge. Connection charge revenue was something that they took particular note of. You saw in the chart how it had a rapid rise during the period of expansive growth in the Las Vegas Valley and then fell off with the economy in a very drastic way. The IRPAC committee recognized the volatility of the connection charge revenue and chose to set a certain threshold for connection charge revenues above which the revenues would be used to either defease outstanding debt or avoid the incurrence of future debt. In other words, manage as best we can the debt service side of the equation. So at $16.1 million, that's where the threshold was drawn. Any revenues earned above that level will be used to either take out existing debt or avoid the incurrence of future debt. That was a very prudent recommendation on the part of the IRPAC committee. Likewise, our funding model was developed around ending fund balance of approximately $280 million, which represents 1 year of principal and interest on outstanding debt at the peak. And it's very important, as I'm sure you all are aware, to maintain the credit quality of particularly an infrastructure-driven organization that you know over time needs to go into the capital markets to borrow money. I will let you know today, too, that based on a call we received from Standard & Poor's yesterday, they reaffirmed the Las Vegas Valley Water District's credit rating at a AA plus with a stable outlook, which is very, very high investment grade, and certainly receiving the stable outlook at this point in time in the economy is something that we're very pleased with. And given the fact that the Water Authority generally borrows through the Water District, it's an extremely important point. So what does that mean for rates on a going forward basis? The committee recommended that the funding gap be filled equally with variable and fixed charges, the variable charge being the commodity charge That's charged based on how much water is used. And the infrastructure charge is the fixed charge based on the relative size of the meter. And you can see by looking at this chart, by 2017, the commodity charge would increase by 18 cents from its current level of 30 cents per 1,000 gallons to 48 cents. The infrastructure charge would be raised by $3.11, and you can see looking at this chart what the phase-in actually looks like for those rates. If you were to look at that on a which one is this, John?
10,000 gallons.
This is the 10,000? The increase in the water rate over the five-year period for a typical 10,000-gallon user with a 5/8 or 3/4 inch meter would go from $37.36 a month, which includes both wholesale and retail charges, to $42.28 in 2017. And again, you can see the effect of the phase-in. And this gives another look for a slightly higher user at 15,000 gallons, would go from $49.28 at current rates up to $55.11, a slightly higher increase than at 10,000 gallons usage because there's a higher consumption level, and of course half of that increase is driven by the commodity rate.
So where we are right now, the Water Authority Board accepted the ERPAC's recommendations last Thursday, September 26th. We gave a presentation to the Las Vegas Valley Water District Board earlier today. We're with you this evening, and we'll give this presentation to North Las Vegas, their city council, tomorrow night. We're asking that the staff of the three retail agencies work together to prepare the business impact statement. That business impact statement will then be brought to each of the water purveyors at your November meetings, when we'll ask you to also set a public hearing. And then that public hearing, probably first meeting in December, would be when you would be asked to actually take formal action upon this. So that would allow us to begin implementation after the first of the year and do the 14-15 step in to avoid the rate shock as Guy described. And with that, we'll be happy to answer any questions.
Before I take any questions, I do have one yellow card. Kelly Martinez wishes to speak. And then after Kelly, then we'll open it up for questions.
Good evening. Kelly Martinez with the Las Vegas Metro Chamber of Commerce. Address? 8363 West Sunset Road, number 250, Las Vegas, Nevada, 89113. The Las Vegas Metro Chamber of Commerce supports the recommendations of ERPAC because of the wide community engagement that was used in this process. There were many diverse voices at the table and strong participation from the community. The Metro Chamber would like to acknowledge the transparency of ERPAC and the open process that was made available to the public. We would like to thank Ms. Mulroy and her staff for their efforts. The recommendations are a fair solution, as both businesses and residents depend on a reliable long-term water solution. Everyone needs to be invested in our water infrastructure. This is especially true during this 14-year drought that we are experiencing. We need to support the construction of the third straw to Lake Mead. Finally, the Metro Chamber would like to thank the ERPAC members for their efforts and the time that they had given to the process over the years. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would wish to address us on this issue, on this agenda item? I'll turn over any questions at the dais, comments?
I just wanted to thank you so much for all the hard work. I know that this isn't something that that is done in a vacuum. It's not something that's done just really quick. That I know that there's been a large process, a long process to go into this. So I look forward to seeing the business impact statement and seeing what that has to say. But I want to thank you and the whole team and everyone who's worked so hard on this to help figure out the situation with our water issue.
Thank you very much, Councilwoman.
Well, Mayor, just wanted to thank also Mr. Ensminger for all the work and the Water Authority and staff. And then also I just wanted to note that we had three Henderson residents on the ERPAC as well, Phil Ralston, Bob Kasner, and Mike Foreman. I think they were all helpful in the process, and they kept me aware of what was going on, and the end result being really a 50-50 split for the increase between you know, being able to conserve a little bit and determining your cost based upon how much you use, and then the rest of it being fixed so that people know exactly how much income is coming in from that. So I think it was a fair mix that everyone could get together and agree on. And so, you know, at the end of the day, the Water Authority Board accepted all of the recommendations of ERPAC. We didn't change anything. So what we're going to see in the rates and what comes back to us is essentially a unanimous decision of the board to accept, I think, what was near unanimity on the ERPAC committee as to all of these recommendations. So I don't know if anybody else has anything to say. But
I also appreciate this, and I know that you're going to be coming back with the business impact study, and I think it's important in that discussion to talk about how really reasonably priced water rates are here in Southern Nevada, how we really, when you look at a lot of other communities, they're paying significantly more per gallon of water than we are. So I think that would be important to include in the conversation as you come back with the business impact study.
Absolutely, we'll include that information.
And also to follow up, the Henderson Chamber was obviously kept a close eye on it as well. Scott Mulrath was in, I think, most of the meetings. So when we go through the process of the business impact statement, hopefully, you know, our businesses will be a little bit more aware of what's going on this time around than, you know, the first go around, and it shouldn't be quite as much of a shock. And hopefully we'll get some good feedback going forward for our changes that we'll have to make at the end of the year. So I'll move to accept the presentation and direct staff to prepare the business impact statement.
All right, we have a motion on the floor. If there is no further discussion, please cast your votes. And post. Motion carries. Mr. Snow.
Thank you, Mayor. We now go to the public hearings portion of your agenda. And item 31 is a public hearing for Nevada West.
Mayor and Council, approval of this application would amend the land use category on the 16.1-acre parcel from commercial to high-density residential and amend the Traverse Point Master Plan from community commercial with master plan overlay to high-density residential with master plan overlay, rezone the from RH24MP to RH24MP PUD, and allow for the development of a 336-unit multifamily subdivision on the southwest corner of Gibson Road and Wigwam Parkway. Planning Commission recommends approval.
All right, this is a public hearing, which I now declare open. We'll have the applicant.
Oh, good evening, Mayor and Council Members. John Marciano, 218 Lead Street, representing Mr. Woolley and Mr. Egbert, who are present. Mayor, we concur with all the conditions of staff and the unanimous Planning Commission recommendation of approval. I know Mr. Day and his partner are here, and there may be others. If it would be okay, could we just reserve some time to address any concerns and answer any questions and to put some items into the record?
Yeah, that'll be all right. So this is a public hearing. I so far have two cards, Mr. Stephen Day, followed by Mr. James Nance.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, City Council. As you are already aware, we are opposed to the proposed zoning change. I own the building, the 1060 Wigwam Parkway in Henderson. Our building is located directly across the street from the proposed development, we would oppose. When we bought the building, we had certain expectations based on the master plan at the time that the property across from us would be commercial. This will be the second change to the property directly across from our business park, and we would request and ask that that the City Council substantially comply with the current existing master plan and deny the application. Thank you.
Good afternoon or good evening. My name is James Nance, and I'm also at 1060 Wigwam or 1895 Fairfield in Henderson. Are we using the Elmo tonight? Is that part of the presentation? Or
if you'd like.
We showed these maps to you before, but I think since we're making the record, we might as well go over them. I'm reading from the original introduction going back to 1999.
Okay, yeah.
And I'll get to that. It's the one on the top. Very good. From the original introduction, this property is owned by Landwell and has been. When they originally put forth the master plan for this city, they addressed it to the city as Traverse Point Business Center as a light industrial and office park developed by the Landwell Company. Is located in Henderson, Nevada, and is bounded by US 93, 95 to the east, I-215 to the south, Wigwam Parkway to the north, and Stephanie Street to the west. And that's the master plan we're here to talk about this evening. The reason that we object, as my partner mentioned, is primarily when we purchased our building, it was under the master plan and the belief that the area, looking at this map, which we've looked at before, you can see this is before the freeway 215 was put in place. Specifically, the area that was previously changed by the city where the apartments are is where my finger is, and the property that we're addressing then today is next to Gibson in the corner. I can switch maps. Thank you. Again, this is the zoning map. So we're talking about this particular parcel, which is next to Gibson Road. Our buildings are directly across from this, and then there's also some commercial buildings that were entitled light in industry, which were concrete tilt-ups office with the garage doors. The thing that I think the council should consider when deciding whether or not to make these changes, you look at what were we promised back when we purchased our building. It was supposed to be commercial. The owner was Landwell at the time. They're the ones that came in and developed this property. They're the current owners of this property and are now asking the zoning change. And I think one of the concerns the council has is, well, this is vacant land. It's been vacant, obviously been vacant since the city annexed it in 94, and then the master plan was passed in 99. It's been vacant since we've owned our property since 2006. And the concern is, well, would you rather have a vacant land or these apartment complexes? We have nothing against apartment complexes. We've all lived in apartments. What I wanted to point out for the city council is just down the street across from some previous apartments, it's already zoned for the zoning requirements, which the applicant is asking for. So when the city is determining whether or not you want to comply, substantially comply with this master plan, I think you have to consider, why would we make this zoning change when there's vacant land on the very same street within the master plan community that's already zoned for what the applicant is asking? The response we had was, well, who owns that property? And I don't believe that that's relevant. Why the concern would be whether or not Landwell owns the property down the street that's already zoned for high density residential versus the property that's zoned for commercial across from our building. We just don't believe that the council would be substantially complying by disregarding what's been in existence when we purchased and the other commercial property owners across the street. Thank you.
All right, this is a public hearing. I have no other yellow cards. Is there anyone else in the audience that wishes to speak for or against this item? Okay. Need to have you state your name.
Name's Michael Thomas. Okay. I own 1100 Wigwam Parkway, which is directly across the street as well. I own one of the commercial buildings. I see this project as a good thing for the area, and I support it.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Mr. Marciano.
Very, very briefly, Mayor, I just would like to thank Mr. Day and Mr. Nance for, they've been quite courteous. I mean, quite strident, but quite courteous. I think the overall gist of the argument is, what were we promised when we purchased the property? It's my understanding that Mr. Day purchased that building in 2006. I would respectfully request the ability to put into the record a memorandum from Scott Majewski, who is the principal planner from the city of Henderson, that's dated September 20th, 2013, and it provides a chronology of the zoning on that property. Mr. Nance is absolutely correct. At one point in time, it was community commercial, but in March of 2006, there was a tentative map that approved a mixed-use development, which had 584 multifamily dwellings. I believe that's approximately a month or two before Mr. Day purchased it. So I would respectfully submit that that is the response to that argument. Regarding the master plan, you are well aware of the expertise of your staff. If we could put into the record your staff report, which recommends approval and addresses the compatibility. This is the second phase. There are, Mr. Day referenced two zone changes. I did the first one, but I'm old and I'm getting tired, so I don't remember. I don't believe there was any protest for that first one. Those apartments have been occupied for, I believe, nearly a year, and I'm not aware of any incompatibility of any kind. This will be the second phase. If you put the two projects together, I believe there's approximately 30 units more than what was approved in March of 2006. So I honestly believe that addresses the concerns that were articulated. Mayor, if I could have your permission to augment the record, I've got a number of photographs as well as your backup information, which recommends approval in addition to the staff report and that memorandum. And with that, we'll try and answer any questions.
Okay. Are there any questions at the dais? Councilwoman March?
I guess more comments. You know, I guess it's been pretty apparent to all of us that a lot has changed between 2006 and 2013. We've seen changes in plans at Inspirata, and we've seen changes in plans at Lake Las Vegas, and all across Henderson and all across the valley, frankly, we've seen a lot of changes. Market conditions have certainly made that happen. You know, in a perfect world, we would have seen the commercial development six, seven years ago, but the market wasn't there, and clearly the market's not there today. There's a high vacancy rate for office in the valley right now, and it could be years before that ever changes. You know, I think that there's an opportunity to build a product here, a multifamily housing product here that will meet the needs of the community. And frankly, I'm not convinced that it's going to impact negatively office development that's in the area. I think that, frankly, there's a lot of folks who could live in those housing units that might work in those office buildings in the future, whether it's secretaries or assistants or medical assistants or whatever. I think that there's an opportunity certainly to provide housing for the marketplace. Again, in a perfect world, it might be a different situation, but the fact is we're dealing with some very different times today than we were in 2006, and I'm sorry that there were representations made to folks who purchased back in 2006, but I think today is a different day.
Any others? Councilwoman Schroeder?
Yes. I have a question for our legal, for Mr. Buchanan. Mr. Day had mentioned about complying with the current master plan being legally obligated. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Yes, my co-counsel, Sally Gilotti, that's familiar with these issues, we can have her chime in.
Sorry, Ms. Gilotti, to put you on the spot.
Yes.
Over here, the short mic. Mayor and Council, and I'd ask Stephanie Garcia to chime in if I misstate anything, but we have approved land and zoning use for this area. It's within the right of the applicant to request these types of changes. The staff reviewed those changes and made recommendations based on the request of the applicant. I believe the staff recommendation was for approval. There's no legal obligation for us to stick with a plan that was adopted in the past if it meets our criteria for the new applicant use. Stephanie, my phrasing may not be exactly right.
It sounds great. One of the other things that we do, in front of you, you see an application for both a land use plan amendment and a zone change. So when if the two are to be approved, the zone change will then continue to be in conformance with the land use plan.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Well, I'd just like to say that, you know, that this is kind of difficult. You see a piece of property that has actually had some development on a portion of it within the last 6 or 7 years. And then the other portion, which has actually remained vacant for years and years, even before it came into the city, I guess, for that matter. I know one of the concerns was values of properties. And so I don't take a zone change very lightly, or, especially in light of, you know, how is that going to affect property values? But I honestly believe in this situation with, you know, whether the existing zoning is commercial or if this is approved to the multifamily, that there's very rarely a time in the city where I think where we rezone something and a subsequent development comes in that there is a loss of property value. So I feel a little bit good about that argument that there won't be, you know, the loss to property value. Now, the other issue, of course, is how does a rezone affect adjacent property? And in this case, across the street from a commercial and some office that is, by the way, very, very well done, too. So that's been the difficult thing for me to sit and decide, is this going to be a detriment to that area? You know, 5, 10 years ago, we're trying our best to plan a very good city and a very orderly city. And I think we've done a pretty good job over the years. And in this area, I think if I were going to err, if there was going to be an error, I think I would rather see some development there than to have the property remain vacant. Because quite frankly, you're right, Councilman March, times have changed drastically. And I'm not sure that we would see any development in that area if we kept it commercial. And quite frankly, if this is, and I believe what you're promising, what you're alluding to, is that this is just almost like a phase two of what is already there. It seems to have been successful. It's represented that it's going to be a higher end rental. So I feel that even though it's difficult, that I would rather see us rezone this and continue the phasing of the multifamily. If there's no further comments, then I'm going to head and make a motion that we approve CPA 13-500284, ZCA 10-660015-A4, ZCA 13-500285, and DRA 13-500286, subject to findings of facts, condition, and waivers. And if there's no further discussion or comment, cast your votes and post. That motion carries.
Thank you very much,
sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Item 32 is the accompanying resolution for item 31 for Gibson Multifamily Nevada West applicant. And if you'd like to adopt this resolution, that would be resolution number 4096.
I move that we adopt resolution 4906 for CPA 4096 for CPA 13-500-284. If there's no further discussion, cast your votes and post. That motion carries.
Item 33 is a public hearing for McDonald Properties.
Mayor and Council, approval of this item would amend the land use category from public semi-public to very low density residential on 9.6 acres and low density residential on 0.5 acres and from very low density residential to public semi-public on 10 acres. It would also amend a zone change and master plan from PSMPH to RS-2-MP-H on 9.6 acres and RS-4-MP-H on 0.4 acres, and from RS-2-MP-H to PSMPH on 10 acres, all with master plan and hillside overlays to allow for minor lot line adjustments and transfer allowable site disturbance from planning area 7A to planning area 7 phase 2. And it would also amend a tentative map for the purpose of amending a 130 lot residential subdivision on 110.1 acres within the McDonald Highlands Master Plan. Planning Commission recommends approval.
All right, this is a public hearing which I declare open. We'll have the applicant.
Barbara Baird, 205 South Stephanie Street, with me is Paul Baikowski with McDonald Highlands. We concur, sorry.
All right, this is a public hearing. I have no yellow cards for this. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak for or against this item? Now would be the time to do it. If not, I'll close the public hearing, open up to any questions on the dais or motions.
I'll make the motion to approve. Do you want me to go through all the numbers? It's going to take a long time. Can I just do a motion to approve? Is that legal? That's legit, isn't it?
Sure.
All right, motion to approve.
Okay, we have a motion for approval. If there's no further discussion, please cast your votes and post.
Are they really?
Motion carries.
Your next item is item 34, which is the accompanying resolution for item 33. The applicant's McDonald Properties. The resolution would be resolution number 4097.
And I'll move for the adoption of that resolution. If there's no further questions, please cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
We now go to your bills to be read into title portion of your agenda. The following bills are being read into title and will be referred to the committee meeting of October 15th, 2013 for discussion in one motion. Item 37, which is bill number 2786 for CA-22 annexation of 7.67 acres in West Henderson. Item 38 is bill number 2787 for PH-31-ZCA-10660015-A4, Gibson Multifamily, a.k.a. Lake Mead North. Item 39, bill number 2788 for PH-31-ZCA-13-500285, Gibson Multifamily. Item 40, accompanying bill number 2789 for PH-33-ZCA-0666-0018-A16, Foothills at McDonald Ranch. Item 42, bill number 2791 for CA-30-ZCO-04-670012-A5, Ladera Villas Condominiums, Lofts Unit 2. Item 44, bill number 2793, which amends Henderson Municipal Code Chapter 2.47.085, citywide fee schedule for public records and document services.
And all these would be a recommendation. Well, no, I'll move to refer all of these bills to our committee meeting of October 15th, 2013. Cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
Thank you. We now go to the public comment portion of your meeting this evening.
All right. I do not have any yellow cards for the public comment portion of our agenda. This is the time, if you have anything that you would like to bring before us, now would be the time to do that, but we cannot take any action on anything that is presented to us tonight. Seeing none, then Mr. Snow will move on.
Thank you, Mayor. We now go to the unfinished business portion of your agenda. That brings us to item 45. Which is a zone change amendment and a conditional use permit amendment for Carnegie Senior Living.
Mayor and Council, approval of this application will amend a zone change with PUD overlay to allow for a change in the site plan, architecture, and height of the building. There is a waiver requested for parking, and it would also amend a use permit to increase the number of units from or up to 156 units and 170 beds at a density of 31.2 units per acre, and Planning Commission recommends approval.
All right, do we have the applicant?
Hello, Mayor and Council, Howard Perlman, 178 Windjammer Court, Henderson, Nevada. And I'm gonna keep it very brief because I've been up here so many times on this. We feel that we have a great project. We're enthusiastic. We're excited about getting it going as quickly as possible. We love the street that we're on Carnegie. We feel we're going to be an asset to the street, to the neighborhood. So our goal is to build the best project of this type in this city, in this area. So with that, I'm take any questions that you might have.
Okay, before we take any questions, I do have three cards on this item. So Sherry Kim, following Sherry is Marilita. Is it Kim or Kime?
It's Kime. I screwed it up last.
All right. And then following Mary Alita is Galen.
Hi, Sherry Keim, 511 Jimmy Joe, Henderson, Nevada. I kind of feel for all of us, this is a lot. Hopefully we can close it up today. I still feel the project's still too large for the footprint of the land. I just want assurances that the Carnegie Street will be developed fully, both north and south, and reflect what it looks like south of that. Okay?
Good point.
That really hasn't been, I reviewed the records on the online website, and there's really no plans for that. There's no mention of that. Okay. And we need to get that assurance more than just verbally. In addition to that, the entrances, I'm a little confused. There wasn't anything submitted to, on the web at least, to City Council, but there were some agreements from surrounding homeowners, and it looks like there are two entrances and exits off Carnegie. In addition, I'd just like some clarification, because three seems a little intense for Carnegie on that. Okay, that's
all right. Mary Alita, and then Galen.
Hi, Honorable Mayor and City Council. My name is Marietta Keim, 501 Jimmy Joe Court, Henderson. I'm going to answer a few questions, or counter them, I guess, from Mr. Perlman's letter. He said, I have letters to support from all the residential neighbors abutting the north. This may be. That's the seven homes that he's paying $3,500 plus giving 8 feet of property to. I guess they're for it. But on the other hand, I turned in a petition on 9/17 at the meeting that had 30 names terribly opposed to it. Also, I have more petitions. Another man had one that wasn't able to be here tonight. This is from the Planning Commission, or during the Planning Commission meeting. There were 17 names opposed to this then. And then on this, it said see letters. So I guess these people also sent letters to the council. And then he had another petition, especially addressing the Carnegie Street with this. And there were, I think, 28 names he had. And then there's two other names. So again, we're up to 61 opposed, plus the 17 opposed at the planning meeting. Okay, going on with that, and I want this to be public record, along with the other one that I didn't see posted on the web. Which was from 9/17, I believe, and the other one was? Yeah, it was. I have a copy of it. Okay. The other thing, he says, I will fix the problem at Carnegie that I didn't create at my own expense, creating two southbound lanes. What about the northbound? If you look at Horizon and Carnegie, and see how these big lanes come down from the hill. I mean, it's almost too wide for that intersection. Then it goes right down into nothing. I've been aced out of there so many times wondering if the car was going to get it or not. And then as you go Kenneth and beyond, then it goes up to four again. So this is really a bad problem. And I don't think just putting two lanes on the southbound is going to do it. So please look at that first. And also, is this fixing of Carnegie going to be before the rest of the development is started? Are we going to fix that first or vice versa? I think that's a big question. Okay, the other thing, the left. I will create a left in, left out into the shopping center from Carnegie at my own expense. I don't know how much is rumor and how much isn't, but what I'm told by several people in the shopping center that there's going to be an access out right up against the wall, which will be across from Kenneth, where the people are being paid off, right up against that wall, and then another one that'll come out where the bread company is. Two of them with left turns with the school. I don't know. I know my time is up here, but that is really a concern. And then I want to thank Deborah March, who made this remark at one of the first meetings when she said, I think this project is a 100-pound project stuffed into a 50-pound bag. I thank you. That's just the way I see it. And Mr. Martz, I know you said last time that the people have to put up with something in that hole. I agree with you. But please don't take our neighborhood away and give us more traffic. It's so hard to get out from Teton Ranch. We also have two driveways or accesses onto Carnegie. When school's in session, it's a nightmare getting out. So, thank you.
Galen? Oh, take care of you? Okay, all right. I have no other yellow cards. Is there anyone else in the audience that wishes to address us? If not, then we'll have the applicant come up. Hopefully you've taken some notes. And then I don't know, Mr. Manan, if you're prepared to answer. I know Carnegie was a pretty big concern, and I think we have some answers for you on that.
Yes, with regards to Carnegie Street, if I said that we were fixing the two southbound lanes, I misspoke. We're fixing the two northbound lanes. Those are the lanes that need to be fixed because there's only one lane there right now. So in working with the city traffic engineer, we have a design to create two full lanes with a bicycle path along that. We are going to create a left turn into that shopping center that doesn't exist there right now. And I believe that we've already agreed to make all of these improvements along Carnegie Street, either concurrent or at the beginning of our construction or before construction begins. So we would work that out with traffic. And then to answer the question from the first person that spoke, there is one drive that exists. I'm sorry. There is one drive that exists. It really doesn't service our project. It services the shopping center, and we aren't changing that, and we aren't doing anything with that one drive. We are adding a drive on the far north part of our project, and again, the city traffic engineer has reviewed that and said that that was the best place for our in and out traffic movement. I think that was all the questions.
Okay. And I guess if we can just kind of get
Mayor, members of the council, with regard to the northbound lanes, there is a right-of-way issue on the opposite side of the road from this project. We are attempting to acquire that right-of-way to finish them in their ultimate configuration. In the event we don't do that, we still have the potential to put in the two northbound lanes with realignment of the center line. So we have a plan A and a plan B, and we will make sure that those are implemented on the submitted the drawings when they're submitted for review.
Thank you.
You know, if I may, I do have one question that just came to mind. So on the south side of Horizon Ridge in Carnegie, is that street section, street width, the same if we get the right-of-way on the north side of Horizon Ridge? I know whether it's, are they the same width?
I believe that they are. I'd have to take a look. And my traffic engineer isn't here tonight.
Okay.
But I'm not aware that they're different sizes. I'm aware that on the north side, it's incomplete and all the right-of-way has not been dedicated. That's why it's narrowed down.
Okay. That's what I was looking for. Any other questions, comments, or?
I do have a question. Mr. Perlman, I forgot what the initial number is of units that you requested when you first presented this project.
I believe it was 221.
So you've gone from 221 to 156, am I correct? So you have gone down a third, basically, in the number of units that you have requested, which I applaud you for, because I thought the 221 was a little excessive for that piece of land. I just have to say, because after the last meeting and I listened, I went to your other project on Paseo Verde, and I've been there now probably 7 or 8 times at different times of the day. And I just have to say that I just don't see a lot of traffic in that facility coming in and out. And so I think that the neighbors are going to be pleasantly surprised if you can stagger your times of your employees coming so they aren't coming at the same time that the school is going into session and being let out. And I think that if you can address that in your staffing issues, that you will alleviate a lot of those concerns.
Do that.
Just can I don't know if Mr. Perlman wanted to answer or anything. Guess not. just so I can be clear, Mr. Minnan, is us addressing the two lanes going north, is that a part of a condition in that he would have to meet, the applicant would have to meet with a later application, or are we just kind of?
It would be in the plan review process. So in order to approve his permits going forward, we would make sure that those were implemented in the plan design.
Okay, so I mean, it's more than just talking about it. We're going to have to deal with it at that point.
He gets no permit without it.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you, Robert.
And I think it is a very different project today than it was at Planning Commission in terms of the overall size. There isn't a waiver for the open space, and the parking I think is actually greater at this point than it was than it is at Merrill Garden. Well, is it a Merrill? Well, I mean it's way more than what we started with. But I guess the what was my question going to be? I've lost it now. But anyway, it's a whole lot different project than it is. So I appreciate Mr. Perlman coming to the table and reducing it down by about a third from what we had to begin with. So I'm pretty confident it's going to be a good project at this point. And hopefully, I think that once that road is fixed, I think we're going to see some big improvement.
Mayor, I have a quick question. How long is this construction going to take to build? And when do you plan on starting and ending?
It would be great if we could start in about 7 or 8 months. And construction should take 8 to 10 months, just kind of depending.
Okay. Yeah. And so throughout the construction, and I'm only asking this because this was brought up to me from someone else, the vehicles that are going to be at the property, the construction vehicles, the vehicles from the construction workers, where will they park? Because I realize that it's Carnegie is a very small street, and you know, then you've got Horizon Ridge, you've got the neighbors. So
right.
Out of concern for the neighbors during the construction, how do you plan to take care of the construction vehicles and the employees that will be working there?
Well, hopefully we could fit all the construction vehicles on our construction site off to the side. But the church that owns a shopping center adjacent to us has graciously offered to allow us to fence off and use their parking, you know, their the dirt portion of their lot along Carnegie Street. And we'll probably take them up on that if it's okay with the council and if it's okay with Public Works.
Okay, I just want to make sure that the neighbors aren't that inconvenienced with construction workers parking on the residential streets.
We'll make sure of that.
Okay, thanks.
I remember what I was asking. We have the right plans now, right, Mr. Perlman?
I went and I checked and double checked and triple checked.
Okay, and that's the one where we've reduced it essentially. There's essentially no 4 stories,
right?
Except for the basement of the one little section.
Right.
All right.
Well, I think that this is a significantly scaled back project, and I think it fits better on this site. And I think clearly the work that needs to be done on Carnegie is essential to the success of this project and to the well-being of the neighborhood. And I would just encourage you to be a good neighbor to the folks in the neighborhood and in any policies or decisions that you decide to implement, whether it's start times and whatever, is just to be mindful of the residents who live there and the hours of use with the schools and all the traffic on Carnegie as well.
We will, Deborah.
All right. Any other comments, motions?
I'll move to approve them.
I'll move to approve this at Carnegie Senior Living with the conditions. And if there's no further comments, please cast your votes.
Thank you.
and post. Motion carries.
Thank you very, very much.
Mr. Snow?
Your next item is item 46, which is the accompanying resolution for item 45 for Carnegie Senior Living. And the recommendation is to adopt resolution number 4099.
That would be my motion. Please cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
Thank you again.
Next item is item 48, which is an appointment for the Southern Nevada Regional Housing Authority Board of Commissioners.
And I would like to appoint Anand Nair. If there's no further discussion, please cast your votes. And post. Motion carries.
Item 49 is Bill number 2784, which amends Henderson Municipal Code, Chapter 4.85 for reflexology. The recommendation is to adopt Bill number 2784 as Ordinance number 3068.
Mayor, that would be my motion.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Cast your votes. And post. Motion carries.
Item 50 is Bill number 2785, which repeals Henderson Municipal Code 4.100 Vacation Certificate Business. The recommendation is to adopt Bill number 2785 as Ordinance number 3069.
Mayor, I'll move for its adoption.
All right, we have a motion. Please cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
We now go to the new business portion of your agenda, and item 51 is the performance evaluation for our city clerk.
All right. Madam Clerk.
Honorable Mayor and Council, it is my pleasure to review with you the City Clerk Annual Summary that highlights the 2013 accomplishments and 2014 goals for the City Clerk's office. This summary has been provided to you in your backup material. Like many other cities like many other offices in the City Clerk's office has experienced budget cuts and staff reductions. This year, we were able to streamline processes and realign positions to return over $30,000 to the general and DSC funds. Additionally, we eliminated one position, resulting in an $86,000 annual savings. In coordination with the city's emergency management team, my office developed a continuity of operations plan to serve as the guiding document to ensure the execution of our missing essential function in the event of an emergency. To further secure readiness, we have also developed a records emergency action plan to ensure essential records are readily accessible in the event of emergency. The City Clerk's Office has participated in two key Henderson quality initiatives. As part of the customer service enhancement efforts at City Hall, part-time staff were hired and trained to staff customer service information desks at both ends of City Hall. Every person entering City Hall is now greeted and offered assistance. In 2013, lobby staff assisted nearly 40,000 citizens that entered City Hall. We also contributed to the contract workflow process improvement to standardize contract formats and routing. The effort improved efficiency, streamlined the process, and increased accuracy. During the 2013 Nevada legislative session, City Clerk staff reviewed over 40 bills, 22 of which were related to elections, records law, or the open meeting law. In 2010, my office contracted with Muni Code Corporation to review and reformat the city's code and document inconsistencies requiring ordinance updates. The reformatting was complete in 2011, and we have continued to work closely with the City Attorney's Office this year to make significant progress in eliminating inconsistencies and updating state law references. This year, staff scanned over 734 pages, processed over 3,000 plans, scanned over 82,000 documents, processed over 1,500 passports, and responded to over 3,000 records requests, and also processed over 1,200 agenda items. In support of the Council's vibrant community goal, dedicated City Clerk staff office staff has volunteered more than 480 hours of their personal time this year to various community groups. As a department, we raised almost $1,000 for Special Olympics, adopted basic high school homeless students, and donated clothing and Christmas gifts for them and their families. And we continue to donate school supplies to support Robert Taylor Elementary School. I am proud to say that two City Clerk staff members have earned their Master Municipal Clerk certifications, three have earned Certified Municipal Clerk certifications, and two members, John and Amber, are currently working on their certifications. On a personal note, I was reappointed by Governor Brian Sandoval to serve on the State Historical Records Advisory Board. I'm a founding member of the Basic High School Alumni Foundation, and I serve as Vice President of Safe House. I continue to be actively involved in various professional organizations, such as the International Institute of Municipal Clerks and ARMA, and I recently obtained my certified public official designation. As a city clerk, my mission is to provide timely and transparent electoral, legislative, and record-keeping services. With this mission as my platform, my goals for the next year include indexing, scanning, and providing access to various financial, historical, and permitting records and information via the internet. Automate the agenda process for more than 20 boards and commissions, providing consistency, transparency, and ensuring all of our boards and commissions are also in compliance with the open meeting law. We will also be replacing council chambers' hearing impaired equipment to meet current ADA requirements. And finally, my office will work closely with the city attorney's office to establish the charter committee as required by the new 2013 legislative session. I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to continue to serve the city that I love and was born and raised in, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions or comments at the dais?
I'd just like to compliment Sabrina for her thoughtful and astute leadership of the city clerk's office. You know, she's responsible for so many things, elections, public records, and just being the front door, basically, to City Hall and folks' access to City Hall. She's returned over $30,000 to the General and DSC Enterprise Funds. She's participated in the Henderson Quality Initiative and implementing that in her department. She developed the Continuity of Operations Plan and the Records of Emergency Action Plans and reformatted the city codes. She's been responsible for really bringing us into the next century, really, and I have to commend her for her hard work and for the leadership that she brings to the city. And obviously there's three leadership positions that we are responsible for, and that's the city manager, the city clerk, and the city attorney, and she really does a good job in carrying out her role with the city, and it's so important. And she's our liaison into the city at the front door.
Okay. Any other comments? Well, I would just like to say, and I guess we kind of started it with our city attorney's evaluation. You know, budgets are what they are, and I really wish that there was some way that I could feel comfortable about, appropriate compensation, because all the appointeds have done an excellent job. We have a great working team. We really do. But I guess in lieu of that, as I asked during our city attorney's evaluation, I would like to also have our HR department take a look at some way extending the contracts, because I think if there is stability there and assurance that, the appointeds are going to be offered more time than 1 on their current contract, I think that's an incentive just in itself. And then also, we're looking at the budget numbers every single month. We all know that. But I would at least like to have our HR department take a look at what we could do in subsequent years and subsequent evaluations. So I don't know if there's any further comments. If not, I'll accept the annual performance evaluation of our city clerk, and thank you for all that you do. So with that motion, if there's no further discussion, please cast your votes. And opposed. Motion carries. Mr. Snow?
Item 52 is the performance evaluation for your city manager, which is me, and I wanted to come down here to do it because I can't duck really over here, and over there I can. But I wanted to talk to you today about, I read a blog for this man, who is the chairman and chief executive officer of the largest investment bank in the world. That's J.P. Morgan Chase, and his name is Jamie Dimon. And he was talking about how for his board, he thinks it's a very difficult process for a board of directors to evaluate a chief executive. And he had some suggested questions that he shared with his board for evaluating his performance. And I would like to share those questions with you tonight and provide some answers to those questions in that context. And one of the most important questions I think that he thinks that you should be asking is, did your chief executive officer act with integrity? And that's a question that you'll have to answer for yourselves on that, and whether or not you think that I've been honest with you, and whether or not I've been able to keep your confidences, or if I have comported myself with good character. I believe that I have, but I think that only you can answer that question. Another question that he asks is, did the chief executive officer hire and train good employees? And here you see a picture of our police chief. This was the most difficult personnel choice, most difficult hire I have ever made. I believe I made the correct hire, however. You all have an appreciation for how difficult the chief of police job is. And I think that I'd like to point out that Chief Moores, he doesn't want to move the police department in a direction that is a silo, a separate silo from the city of Henderson. There's HPD, and then there's everybody else. He wants to be part of the city of Henderson, and he's made a considerable effort in doing that, and I commend him for that, for being a great team player. He's also made a number of innovations in the department very quickly, and I'd like to commend him for adopting the recommendations of the International City and County Management Association's review of the Henderson Police Department. And we will continue to follow up with you on those recommendations. I commend the chief. I think he's done an excellent job in building this team. Now, Tracy Bauer, when I first hired her, that was one of the easiest personal decisions I had ever made. And let me tell you why. I had never worked with Tracy before, just like I'd never worked with Chief Moores before, but I called up one of her former supervisors, who happens to be an associate of mine. I said, what can you tell me about Tracy Bauer? And he said, that's really easy. I would trust Tracy Bauer with my children. I would trust her with my credit cards. I've given her my social security number, and she has never let me down. Now, since I have come to work with Tracy, I have found that to be true and more. But more importantly, I have never worked with a more consummate professional in my life. And since she has come to the city of Henderson, she has raised the bar in professionalism for us. And I think she's been an excellent hire. Now, Javier Trujillo, I didn't hire him, but I promoted him. And we took a risk on Javier. We knew that he was intelligent. We knew that he was capable. But we put him into a position where he'd never been tested before, and that was to lead our efforts up at the legislature. And boy, did he deliver. And he came before you previously this year and talked about $190 million worth of bills that would have cost the city of Henderson $190 million. And he fended off all of them. And he passed a couple bills that have brought the city of Henderson in $2.25 million annually every year. Now, it's not fair for me to stand here and to take credit for other people's work. But life isn't fair, and so I'm going to do so anyway. And Javier and his team did a tremendous job for the city. And it was, you know, we took a little bit of a risk, but it was a great risk for us to take. Laura Fucci, the award-winning Laura Fucci, the winner of the Dreams Drivers, and there's another D as part of that award that she got. I can't remember what it is right now, that she got from an international organization in IT leadership. And since she has come to the city of Henderson, she is breaking down silos in the IT department and establishing performance management and benchmarking as a way for us to improve. If you talk to anybody on the executive team, they'll tell you what a pleasure she is to work with. And it was a huge coup for us to land Laura Fucci here at the city of Henderson. Barbara Coffey is a new addition to our staff, our new economic development manager, who is doing a great job in carrying on the tradition in great economic development leaders here at the city of Henderson. Now, one of the areas where the city of Henderson is extremely deep in talented people is your utilities department. And Priscilla Howell was the perfect selection for us to run the utilities department. And like I say, they've done a great job in that department of succession planning and developing great leaders like Priscilla is and continues to be. The third question that Jamie Dimon thinks that you should be asking of your chief executive is, did he or she put into place the systems and the products that will strengthen the organization, not just in the short term, but over the long term? And you've heard a little bit about the Henderson Quality Initiative tonight, and our fine city clerk has had a tremendous role in helping that process along, especially in the customer service arena, with what resources she has committed to that process, so that when people come into City Hall, we can have someone greet them and orient them and answer their questions so they can get the types of services that they need. And it's a difficult concept to explain in detail in the six different areas, but I thought that rather than me standing here and be a talking head about them, we would play a little video for you that would explain a little bit about the Henderson Quality Initiative and what has been accomplished and where we're going with that.
HQI is the Henderson Quality Initiative, and it was born by our city manager, Jacob Snow's, vision to be a quality organization, which supports the council's idea and vision of being a premier organization. It's made up of different components. The first is customer service, to ensure that we're providing our customers with the best experience that they could possibly have. We also look at leadership to ensure that we are providing leaders of tomorrow. So not only our executive team participate, but also in developing those employees for the future and succession planning.
I think HQI has been very important for the city of Henderson because I've worked at the city for about 12 years. And in that time, I found it to be a very great culture where we're really trying to improve the way we do things every day. We're an innovative culture, and we're all about customer service. And I think HQI just builds on that to improve quality citywide. We've also initiated a new program called the Henderson Innovation Program, which was the brainchild of Jacob Snow. And what that Henderson Innovation Program, or HIP, is going to do is help us accept employee suggestions for process improvements and innovation here at the city.
Quality Initiative's ultimate goal is to ensure quality throughout the entire organization. We are an organization that have pockets of premier. We see it throughout in our gold medalist Parks and Recreation Department, our accredited police and fire departments. We are a city that has achieved many different things and very high standards, and HQI is ensuring that quality is throughout the entire organization. So we're looking for opportunities to ensure consistency and quality in everything that we do.
I believe with the Henderson Quality Initiative, we have put in place the system, the systems and the products that will add long-term value to the city of Henderson for a number of areas. And it's not something that we plan on just paying a little bit of a lip service and attention to and then dropping that and moving on to the next thing. This is something that we plan on continuing for years to come with the city and look forward to that. Now, the last question that Jamie Dimon thinks you should be asking is, did your chief executive build a real management team? And from my standpoint, when I came here to the city, I was surprised to find out that our executive team, we had some challenges. And while everyone on the executive team, I think, was pulling and was working very hard for the right reasons, they weren't necessarily working together well. And there were some silos, and there were some trust issues. And now that I'm here, I think we've made some significant progress in that. I think there are still issues of trust that remain, and I think there are still issues about communication and how we work together. But I believe that we're working together in a much more functional basis. And I've put in place a tool where the performance evaluations that I will do for every member of the executive team will involve how well they are working together as a team and what they have done to put in place establishing that group as the most important team within the city of Henderson instead of their departments being the most important team. And how that group works together is critical for how successful the city is going to be. We meet together quarterly in a retreat where we talk about these issues very candidly and very honestly. And I really have appreciated the candid nature and the honest discussions that we've had. I haven't been perfect in coming to the city, a long way from it. But because of these people and how they interact, I am a better leader when I listen to them. That's been a tough lesson for me to learn, but it's been very, very important. And we're not there yet, but we're making really good progress in that. And that, to me, is very encouraging. We have worked hard over the last year with a private sector committee and coming in with the staff in the city to establish a vision for downtown. And I look forward to working with the city and the staff to achieving that vision. We also have been presented with a great opportunity to do the same thing for West Henderson in the planning process we are putting into place there. And I look forward to working with the council and the public and the private sector developers as we come up with a similar vision for West Henderson. Very excited about that as well. I was excited about coming to the city of Henderson because I wanted to come to work for an organization who is well known for raising the bar and having high standards. And we work hard, not because we have to, but because we want to, because we care. Why we do this is because we want every person that's a resident of the city of Henderson who does business here to feel like Henderson is the perfect place for them. That's a concept that I feel good about. That's a concept I believe that we are very loyal to. I'm not asking for the employees here to be loyal to me. I'm asking them to be loyal to the city and to that concept. And I believe if we're successful at that, we truly will be a premier organization. I am so proud to be a City of Henderson employee. I'm proud to work for you, and I look forward to working with this group. Thank you.
Well, Councilwoman March.
Thank you, Jacob. When I first met you, Jacob, long before I was with the city, I was at the university, and I knew then you were pretty special. And then I had the opportunity to work with you at the RTC, and I knew you were a strong leader. And I knew when we had the opportunity to steal you away from the RTC that we needed to do that for Henderson. And I have to tell you that you do engender integrity and trust in me. And I would trust you to take care of my son if something happened to me. And I would even trust you to have my mountain bike and my road bike too. I have great trust in you, and you've never let us down. And you know, you come to us if there's an issue or a challenge or you need to just check in on something, and I trust you. You've hired and trained a great group of people, and you continue to, and you're always mindful of the folks that you include in the team, and every one of them, even the folks whose pictures you didn't show, I mean, the team that you have around you are all looking out for the same thing, for the future of this community. What a wonderful place. You've put the systems and products in place to make sure that we're successful, and you adapt, and you're flexible, and if something isn't working, you're willing to take a look at it and modify it and look at all aspects. I mean, you have five different personalities sitting up here who have different things and different wants from you, and you're able to address all of our concerns, but at the same time, make sure that you're leading this city in a very strong and meaningful way. And I have to say, you have engendered teamwork across the city, and I'm so proud of you, and I'm proud to know you, and I'm proud of all the work you do. So thank you very
much. Thank
you.
Well, I think we made a really good choice to have you as a city manager. Although I know that in the beginning it was a little bit rocky because you were new here and you had to get to know all of us. I knew you when you were at the RTC and I was working somewhere else before. And so we've known each other for a long time outside of the city. So I was excited to have you come here because I knew what your integrity is. I knew what your work ethic is. I know how smart you were that, you know, being at the RTC and how you have brought that organization, that agency, up to another level. So so it was really great having you here. And it, starting a new job is difficult. There is a learning curve, but you've come through that. Your communication is much better. That's something that we kind of had to work through in the beginning to, because communication is so important for the whole team, the whole city of Henderson, to ensure that everybody's on the same page. So with that communication, with the Henderson Quality Initiative, I was wondering about staff feedback and how you respond to the staff feedback, because I know that a lot of people are very satisfied, but then sometimes there's some concerns and some questions. Some people have ideas, and they may be a little shy to bring up their ideas because they feel like they've been turned down before in the past, before you got here. So I know that there were some concerns with that. So with the feedback, how are you responding to that feedback? And in, for the quality initiative, I assume that's going to be ongoing. It's not something that we're just doing for now. But I know that there's some staff that would that'd be interested in knowing for themselves about what their ideas are and how you want to implement them, or, you know, so tell me a little bit about your feedback and how you respond to that.
I think the best system that we put in place so far is the Henderson Innovation Program, and that's still being rolled out right now. And that essentially is an incentive program for people to come forward with their ideas that can save the city money, or that can improve the process or provide better customer service. We have yet to establish what the rewards would be for that type of an incentive program. But I think that one has the most potential for everybody to be heard. But beyond that, we went through department by department, all the way down to the line service workers, people that are out on the streets making it happen every day. And we went around department by department and worked with them as part of a strategic and operations plan. And that included getting their ideas for what they think the most important services that they provide are, and operationally how to rank those and how to implement those. And we got a lot of feedback from the employees directly as part of that process. That means we have to create a process where those employees feel safe that they can say whatever they need to say, even though their supervisor's right there. I think we've had a lot of success in doing that. We had a little bit of reference to that in the film that we had. I've established an anonymous blog where on my homepage, anybody can write in whatever question they have. And we answer those questions as quickly as we can. And that's provided an opportunity for a lot of people to make suggestions and go forward with that. We're trying to create an environment where people, especially if they feel like they have a sensitive issue that they want to bring up, that they can bring that issue up regardless of, and not feel like there are going to be any consequences for doing that.
Okay. Yeah, that's great, and I appreciate that too. I just know in the past, before you got here, that there had been some feelings of, well, I've tried to give my ideas, but nobody seems to want to listen. So that's why I wanted to ask you about responding to them and how to do that. And I like the idea of the anonymous blog, because a lot of people are shy to bring up because they feel like, you know, some, if they're trying to inform you of something that you need to know, of concern, they're afraid that something might happen to them, and we don't want that to happen at all. We want people to feel free to be able to let us know if there's something that we need to know to make improvements, that we're here for them. So a couple of the things that that I want to thank you for, the programs that you've initiated, the bicycle program, the bicycle valet, you know, different things like that. Those are some great programs that you've implemented throughout the city to encourage people to get out, enjoy our parks, ride their bicycles. I've seen you riding down the street before, and I've actually, you know, there's a 3-foot kind of a rule. Yeah, the 3-foot rule. where I've given you about 5 foot or more. Just I've gone to the other lane to make sure I don't hit you or any bicyclist. But those programs, I think, are very effective, and it creates even more of a positive image of the city of Henderson and how we want to be a vibrant community and keep our community premier. I want to also thank you for your assistance with helping to reach out to constituents, business owners. You're not just in your office, but you're actually out there with us on the council at our different meetings outside of the office, helping us with the constituents and any kind of constituent concerns that there are, helping to explain processes and how we do things in the city of Henderson. So I really appreciate you helping us with that.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your work.
Thank you.
Councilman Mars?
I think the best tribute that somebody can receive is from those people that work with the people in the city of Henderson. I have to say that I don't talk to many people in the city that are just not thrilled about living here. And they see the positive things that the city are doing, and that is a reflection of you and your team and of the city employees. Also, the people that I have appointed to boards and commissions just are thrilled to be and have that participation. And that goes to the department heads, the people that they're working with in the city. They relish the idea of having input and being productive citizens in the city. And that they want to be on those boards is a reflection of you and your staff, I believe. And third of all, those wonderful people who work with the city, those people who are coming in for our services that need the expertise of the people of the city to be able to further their projects and their developments, and how your staff has been able to work with those people in a very professional and business way is a real testament to you and your staff. I have to tell you, Jacob, I personally believe that the best days of Henderson are in front of us. We have in this whole valley more potential as a city than any place else in the valley. And it is your charge, with all of those wonderful people that you have, is to lead this city in a direction where in 10 years from now, we are going to be transformed again and even a better city than we are today, because we're going to have well-planned growth, and we're going to have really good developments, and we're going to have good programs for our citizens, and we're going to have thoughtful people looking out for them. And that's all under your charge. And like the other councilman, I think that I have all the trust and faith that you and your team, and I think you have done some great hires, and I think that you have given the people that you didn't hire all the support that they've needed to do their jobs efficiently, and I applaud you for that.
Thank you, Councilman.
Jacob's okay. I was first going to point out a lot of those pictures he put up, there was quite a few females, so I think he's done a good job diversifying the higher level of the city with both genders, which I think is always a beneficial thing. I don't know if you had a binder of women that you were looking through. Sorry. It's a joke.
Amber, I think we need to go back to the PowerPoint, please.
No, I think they're great. You know, you mentioned what you kind of stepped into, and maybe we're far enough away from it now to talk about it, but, you know, I feel like I kind of stepped into it, too, in 2011, and maybe some other folks did. I think the city, if you think about the transition that it's been in from term limits kicking in what, 08, you've got an entirely new, minus the mayor, an entirely new city council, and then in the, you know, We lost a city council person under difficult circumstances in that period of time, and then we had to we replaced a city manager, we replaced a city attorney, we've replaced the chief of police, and even the command staff of a police department. And I think for an organization to go through in a complete overhaul of a sitting governing body, and then go through a complete overhaul of your management structure is a pretty, and really probably in the span of about 5 years, I think is probably a pretty significant thing. And I think, you know, what I needed, and I think probably this, whether we were honest with ourselves or not, I think we needed a level of calming influence at some point, because there was a level of, I think, a lot of great employees at department head level and beneath that were doing a great job respectively in their departments. But I'll tell you right now, there was a level of dysfunction at that top level. And I think to be able to come in and deal with that, it's probably been very, very difficult. It was difficult for us, I think. It's surprising. I don't think the community realizes how much we end up having to almost deal with a human resource level at the top of a city, and we almost and then we're, you know, strapped with, I shouldn't say strapped, but we're limited in how easily we can deal with that with the open meeting law and what we can actually do as a board. And it was incredibly difficult to make a decision about how to deal with previous employees here that are no longer here for us. I don't want anybody, any employee in the city, to think that that was at all easy for any of us. It was very difficult to decide who replaces longtime employees who have been here and they're leaving under difficult circumstances. And so while that's incredibly difficult for us and we just had to make a call, I'm sure it was incredibly difficult for you to walk in as an outside person to the organization and try to manage the existing relationships and the existing history that had gone on. And I think you've done as good as you possibly could have done with that. And I think we're kind of, hopefully, kind of coming off that into a more calm period of time where I think everybody has figured out what their role is. I think I get the sense when I talk to employees, and at the certainly the department head level, that everybody is getting along, everybody is communicating with each other, everybody feels like they can communicate. And I think that probably has to come from the top down. And I think it's made it easier for all of us to do our jobs without also having to keep an eye on those issues, because we can't do anything without coming to staff and saying, please help us. We don't get to do anything on our own. We have to ask you to help us. And we have to have a relationship with staff that allows us to do that. Now, I think you look across the valley and some elected officials have a difficult relationship with staff and do it in a different way. I think we try to have a good relationship with staff and do things in a collaborative way, and I think you facilitated that by, at the end of the day, having a calming influence. So I appreciate that. I think, however, that at the end of the day, we're still in the midst of some having to do some pretty tough heavy lifting in terms of our budget situation, some of the plans that you have for the next year, 2 years, 3 years. I don't think you're probably going anywhere for the next few years. And, you know, I agree completely with Councilman Mars that our best days are ahead. I think those are going to come from us having to make some tough decisions going forward on, you know, our finances and what services we provide and how we're going to pay for them. And I know that you're probably, that's a weight on your shoulders probably as much as it is on ours. And I look forward to working with you and everyone else going forward on that. So I appreciate the position that you came into, because I feel like I kind of came into it too, and I think we're pulling out of it. So, thank you.
Well, Manager Snow, I think you can tell from the comments here on this board that we have your full faith and trust in you and the culture that you've improved here at the city. And, you know, my comments go back to again what I said for the city attorney and for the city clerk. You know, I really wish there was a way that monetarily there could be some kind of reward, if you will. The budgets aren't there. You know that. We know that. But I still think, along with the city clerk and city attorney's office, by extending the contracts, giving more time, I think that's under the circumstances. You have our full faith and trust, and I think that's a way of us saying, we want you to stay here. We want you to continue on in the way that you're going. And you know, it's been said before, really, I think our best days are ahead. And we've had some good days. The city has grown from, I've lived here my whole life, from a little city of 5,000 or 6,000 to over 270,000 today. And we've kept up with the challenge because we've had great people in charge of the city, running the city with great attitude. So just keep the culture up. And again, I said it with the city clerk's evaluation, but direct human resources to come back with us with language, extending these contracts for all three appointed, and maybe looking for some way in, you know, next year's budget, if there's some way to have some kind of a financial compensation. So with that, I'll accept the annual performance evaluation of City Manager Jacob L. Snow. And if there's no further discussion, please cast your votes. And post. It was unanimous.
Thank you very much. My privilege to work with you. And that takes us to item 53, which is the financial update, which will be given by the real driver behind the Henderson Quality Initiative, your Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Richard Derrick.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, members of the Council. We recently received the consolidated tax revenue for this past July, totaling $6.5 million. This represents a 6% increase over July of 2012. The largest increase in taxable sales collections were in the areas of motor vehicle and parts dealers, furniture and home furnishings, machinery manufacturing, and electronics and appliance store sales. We have projected a 6.85% increase for the month in the city's five-year plan, so our actual receipts were approximately $54,000 lower than the plan. The July payment is significant as it represents the first month of collection under the revised consolidated tax formula that was approved during the 2013 legislative session. Upon initial review, the formula appears to be functioning as intended, and we will continue to keep you apprised of the revised formula results as revenues are received. On a final note, we have had two very productive meetings with the Special Budget Ad Hoc Committee that you appointed. At our initial meeting, the Mayor welcomed the committee members and expressed the Mayor and Council's appreciation to those serving, and our City Manager provided an overview of the committee purpose. We also had Jeremy Aguero from Applied Analysis provide a general review of local, county, and state governance structures and an introduction of local, county, and state government revenue and expenditures. At the second meeting, we provide an overview of the city's budgetary structure and reviewed budget balancing strategies the city has implemented during the economic downturn. The committee was very engaged, asking several questions and providing valuable insight. On the agenda for tomorrow afternoon, our Human Resource Director will provide an overview of the city's initiatives, employment strategies, and labor relations during the economic downturn. We sincerely appreciate the opportunity to partner with the committee as they work toward providing short-term and long-term budget recommendations to the Mayor and Council to help address the city's infrastructure reinvestment shortfall. And with that, that includes my remarks, and I'd be happy to any questions if you have any.
Any questions?
It truly is gratifying to see the results of the new consolidated formula. I think the formula that you have worked very hard on with the other municipalities, I think goes a long way to really making right what we needed to make right across Southern Nevada and across the state for that matter. So thank you for your hard work, and thank you for your work with the Henderson Quality Initiative as well as this committee that meets on a weekly basis to look at our financial issues. So thank you.
Thank you. If there's no further comments, I'll move to accept the presentation and update, cast your votes, and post. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 55 is an appointment to the Henderson Space and Science Center Board.
You know, I'd like to appoint Colonel Barry Cornish to the Henderson Space and Science Center Board with a term to expire September 30th, 2016. Cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
Item 56 is an appointment for Councilwoman Schroeder to the Redevelopment Advisory Commission.
I'd like to move to appoint John Vanderplug to the Redevelopment Advisory Commission with the term to expire June 30th, 2015.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Cast your votes and post. Motion carries.
Item 57 is a resolution for the provisional order to modify Local Improvement District T-18 and set public hearing date.
Mayor, members of the Council, T-18 is the local improvement district in the Inspirata community. Under the direction of staff, a new engineer's report has been written for that improvement district that reflects the changes in the development agreement that you recently approved. This will result in a net reduction in the assessments. A public hearing will be held in the first meeting in November to address any comments with regard to that engineer's report, which is on file with the City Clerk's office. We're seeking this provisional order to modify the local improvement district and move forward with that.
Okay. Mayor, I'd like to make the motion to adopt resolution number 4100 and set the public hearing date for November 5th, 2013.
All right. We have a motion on the floor. And thank you for all your work. I know it's been very difficult. I see us moving on and looking forward to that public hearing on November 5th. Motion carries.
Item 58 is a resolution supporting local hiring on fuel tax indexing projects. Mr. Patrick Smith is here to make a presentation on this item.
Good evening. Patrick Smith with the Nevada Economic Development Coalition. We're really here to ask you to pass the resolution. We were back here last spring, and thank you for passing the resolution supporting fuel tax indexing. This resolution really takes a step further to say we've passed the fuel tax indexing. Now, with those projects, we'd like to use local labor for all of those construction projects. Really, I didn't have a presentation prepared this evening. If there are any questions, I'd go ahead and take those now.
Well, before we take questions, I do have one card. Again, Kelly Martinez. So if you want to come up to the podium, and then after her comments, we'll have any questions if there are any.
Kelly Martinez with the Las Vegas Metro Chamber of Commerce. The Las Vegas Metro Chamber of Commerce was in support of the passage of the fuel tax ordinance by the Clark County Commission. We believe this is an important investment in our community. The Metro Chamber is in support of the proposed resolution because it would identify opportunities to utilize local workers and companies for the projects relating to the fuel tax indexing. We support small businesses. As you know, the construction industry has seen almost a 50% unemployment rate during the recession. The direct number of jobs that will be created are expected to be between 4,700 and 5,200. With the number of indirect jobs also factored in, it is almost 10,000 jobs. We need to support efforts to put Southern Nevadans back to work. This resolution is good public policy and good for our community. Thank you for your time and for your consideration.
Thank you. So are there any questions, comments?
Just like to thank all of you for staying so late, but then also to thank you for NEDPAC's efforts to see the indexing pass. This is so important to Southern Nevada in terms of creating jobs and getting people back to work. I think the latest numbers were 9.6% stated unemployment, but clearly there's probably much more than that. And looking at giving jobs to folks locally first is, I think, critical to turning that number around and to getting this economy moving again. So thank you again to you, the RTC, to the Chamber, and all of the folks who've championed this. And this is definitely something we need to support and endorse.
Thank you. Councilwoman Schroeder?
I just wanted to mention how important this is to our community. I mean, we want to be a premier community in the city of Henderson, and part of that are the streets and the roads. I know that you've had some criticism regarding, you know, fuel tax. It's the word tax. I've had a couple of people who have said that too. And then in the next breath, they say, oh, by the way, when are you going to fix this road or that road? And that's when I educate them and let them know, well, did you know that this is what pays for those roads? And so while some people are thinking one way and then thinking another way, they're not connecting the two together and how important this is for us to have our vibrant community that we have. So thank you for your hard work.
And thanks for spreading that message, because we'll need to, this effort will go on the 2016 ballot. This is only a 3-year fix.
Okay. There's no further comments. I'll move that we adopt resolution 4101. Cast your votes and post. Motion carries. Is that what it is? Yeah. Now we come to Mayor Council comments. Any comments?
Jacob, isn't there a bike ride coming up that's a city-sponsored event that maybe we should tell the public about, the Spokes?
Yes, there is. Crazy Spokes. We'll begin at 7:30 a.m. at Mission Hills Park. We're going to have a 30-mile ride that day and be featuring a number of City of Henderson trails and great vistas, and then we'll come back later for some food and bike fest and a bicycle parade at 11:30 a.m.
If any of our council members don't have a bike and would like to borrow one, I'm sure we could arrange to find a bike. We get John Mars out there, or Sam, or Jerry.
Well, actually, I'm supposed to be out there, so, and I don't have a bicycle, so I might be.
It's not the bike; it's the 30 miles.
Oh. Don't they have hybrid bikes now?
October 12th.
Yeah,
those I'll bikes that you can sit down in and pedal out. And
I'll take a ride around Mission Hills Park.
We could probably work up some pedal-assisted electric bikes for you.
Are there bicycles built for two? I can sit on the back.
They're addictive, Jacob.
What's that?
Those bikes.
What about them?
They're wonderful.
They are indeed. They are.
I just want to make a quick comment for Sabrina. Didn't say much when your evaluation came up, and then I had thought about it later. But I just want to thank you also for all your hard work that you've done in the city clerk's office. You have thought about innovative ways to save money in the city clerk's office and for the city. And just your participation in the community, I think that you're doing a great job, and in your interest in the city of Henderson to make sure that everything goes smoothly, especially we get quite a few requests for information from all different kinds of places. It could be an individual who's asking for how do you do this or how do you file that. So you know, the information that you provide is vital for our community and to help keep us transparent and open. And so thank you so much for all your work.
Any other comments? All right, then I will set the committee meeting October 15th for 6:45, and this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.